looking back, the whole thing had a kind of pattern, kind of shape when I think about it. I'm not a superstitious man or particularly a deep thinker, but I'm not a young man either. And age gives you a sort of perspective on things. I remember Paul of Tarsus telling me that, and he's no fool. It was a couple of years ago, we were talking about my father. Paul knows my father quite well. He's quite fond of him. Most people are. It's a bit special, my dad. Even after 20 years, still famous. Simon, the man who carried the cross for Jesus. My brother Rufus and I were both grew up in Cyrenaica, in Cyrene. Family of fruit farmers. It's a great place for fruit. 2,000 feet above sea level, the Great Sea 5 miles to the north. Cyrene's a beautiful place too. Finest city, my father would say, in the Pentapolis, the five cities. Cyrene's the finest. In his mind, there's only one place more beautiful, Jerusalem. That's how we came to be there that day, the trip. The trip. My father would say to me when I was younger, he'd say, Alexander, when we make the trip, you'll see such amazing things. We'll visit Alexandria, the city that was founded by your namesake 300 years ago. It was kind of a family joke, you know, the trip, the trip, the trip. We grew up hearing about it. That was the dream. You see, my father, he's a simple man. In those days, he was as strong as anything, but he was still a farmer. But when he spoke about the trip, he became a dreamer. And that was his dream, to spend just one Passover in Jerusalem, make offerings at the temple. My brother and I remember we were teenagers, and you know what teenagers are like, prone to sort of making fun of their parents. And we'd been mocking him about this, the trip, this family joke. And my mother took us to one side and said, no joke, no dream. Your father wants this thing. It will happen. A couple of years later, it did. We were astonished. So we went on the trip, took the overland route, joined the great caravans. We saw Alexandria, we saw Pelusium, we saw Gaza. Saw amazing things. We ended up staying in a house in the pretty country around Bethlehem, about 5 miles south of Jerusalem. The week before Passover, Rufus and I spent all our time in Jerusalem looking at everything, seeing the most amazing things, the temple, the golden city of Solomon and Herod, the Temple of Antonia, the Hippodrome, the changing of the Roman Praetorian Guard. We saw everything. It was amazing to us. But we listened too. You see, the Jews in Jerusalem, they spoke Aramaic and Greek, just like in Cyrene. And so we understood everything that was going on, and we heard some incredible things. The whole city was alive. Jesus, the miracle worker, Jesus, the healer, Jesus, the preacher, Jesus, the prophet. Of course, we took all this back to my father in the evenings. We'd tell him everything we saw, tell him what we heard, and he would listen and just nod and say, I've heard these things too. Don't believe everything you hear. Now, go to bed. Got an early start in the morning. It's going to be very busy. He was right. Jerusalem was packed, full of people. I'd never seen so many people. My father was awestruck by the whole thing. And my brother and I would point out everything we'd seen, and he would just look in wonder. The whole city was full of excitement. And then there was a different kind of excitement. A screaming mob rounded the corner. In front of them was a square of Roman soldiers. And at the head of the procession was a Roman soldier with a crudely painted sign. It said, King of the Jews. At first, my brother and I thought it was some sort of parade, something to do with the Passover celebrations. But then we saw the man inside the Roman square. He was pale, covered in blood. He looked terrible. And he was carrying this huge wooden cross. Not really carrying, he was kind of dragging it, really, struggling with this thing. And then as we watched, he stumbled and fell, and the cross came down on him. Soldiers screamed at him to get up. He couldn't move. So then they looked out into the crowd, and one of them came over to us, and he pointed at my dad and said, "You look strong, carry the cross." My father tried to explain we were just tourists, just pilgrims. But the soldier said, "Doesn't matter, you're pressed into service." And he hit my father with the flat of his sword, not hard, just, I guess, to say, it's the law, this is my authority. My father, well, I thought he might argue at first, but the man under the cross, well, he looked calm and he just watched everything that was going on. So without a word, my father got up, he went over, and he lifted the cross. It was obviously very heavy. He lifted it with one arm, and with his other, he helped this man to his feet. It was Jesus. We didn't know it was Jesus then, but he helped him to his feet. And so we went, my father carrying the cross, supporting Jesus with the other hand. It was a long way. I remember a couple of times I kind of motioned to my father, I'll carry it, I'll take a turn. In those days I was as big and as strong as he was. But my father just shook his head. He looked proud, I suppose. Jesus just staggered along, didn't say a word. Well, once he stopped to talk to some women in the crowd, but that didn't last for long. The soldiers didn't like that. They got a bit rough with him and the crowd. Eventually we came to Golgotha, the place of the skull. And there the procession ended. Some soldiers took the cross away from my dad. My brother and I watched as my dad spoke for a little while to the officer in charge. And then he came over. My brother and I wanted to stay, wanted to watch what was going to happen. And my father said, no. He was a mild man in many ways, but on some things, he could be like steel. We're not staying, he said. That man, is going to be nailed to that cross. He's going to have iron spikes hammered through his hands and feet, and then they're going to lift that cross up and drop it in a hole, and he's going to hang there. That man, he's already had the worst beating I've ever seen in my life. He's no traitor or rebel. He's just a poor preacher. Then my dad said, if this can happen in Jerusalem on the Passover, and this is no place for us, we go home tomorrow. The trip is over.
Is Jesus just a poor preacher? He seemed to die like one, didn't he? On a cross. Poor, vulnerable, exposed, humiliated. Why? Why did Jesus die? Is this a place for us? It wasn't a place for those that witnessed it at the time. They walked away, their heads in shame, in sorrow and sadness. Is that the end of the story? Maybe not. The Gospels present a different person than just a poor preacher. They also present one who said, I am the resurrection and the life. I am the good shepherd who lays down his life for the sheep. I am the way, the truth, and the life. How could Jesus say these things before his death? And how could they come to real fruition following his death? You see, when Jesus died, a few things happened. The sky went black. There was an earthquake. The temple curtain was torn in two. It's as if in the middle of this darkness, some light shone out in power, transforming, giving life where there was death. You see, the purpose of the cross is to give life to you and to me. It means that we don't just see a poor preacher dying on a cross. We see a risen Saviour on Easter Sunday, on the third day, who defeated death, who conquered it, and gives hope to you and to me. If this can happen, then this is no place for us, were the words as that poor preacher died on a cross. But maybe this is a place for you and me as we look at the empty tomb, as we think about why that poor preacher died, to save you and me from our poverty and sin and brokenness. Is this somebody that you need to find out more about this Easter, who can make a difference to your life because he overcame death and offers life for you and for me? We're going to hear a story about someone who came to know about this poor preacher, this risen Saviour, and how maybe his life story can help us answer some of our questions about who Jesus is.
Yeah, I think as some people know, I've spent many years actually away from God. I fell away about 30 years ago. And it was Easter last year where I had the first kind of inkling of a drawing back. Son Simeon's a curate, and he was involved in the Easter service last year, so we watched that. And the vicar there was preaching on the road to Emmaus, and he took it in a way I'd never heard before. He said that here were these two believers walking away from Jerusalem, walking away from everything that had happened. And they were disillusioned, they were downcast, they were depressed when Jesus came alongside them. They said, oh, this guy Jesus, you know, he was a great prophet, he did incredible things. But we hoped that he was the Messiah, but obviously things didn't work out like that. But they were still walking away, and I just kind of felt that's what I'd done. I'd walked away, and so it was the first kind of nudge. Yeah, I became a Christian first when I was about 20, and was quite involved in the church. After a few years, I went to Bible college, did 3 years at college studying, and that's where I met Catherine. And basically then we both felt called to the Jewish people as a special ministry. But after 7 years, it was wearing down. I was working on my own, basically. I was detached from the organization Christian Witness to Israel I was working with, and very isolated. And after 7 years of basically trying to seek out a remnant, it was getting really draining. I was away quite a lot as well, which didn't help at home. I had to do deputation, take Sunday services around to tell people about the work of the mission. And after that, we just felt it was right to leave. I'd no intention of leaving faith, but that's how it happened. And as we left the mission, and then we trained to become teachers, went to university, it was, I suppose, a bit like a boat slipping its moorings. You know, it's there, but slowly it's beginning to drift away, drift away, drift away. And then over the years, I just felt that I'd gone cold. I think about it, a few years ago, I kind of arrived at the position where I thought, well, actually, if you'd asked me, I'd have said, I tried Christianity, and I found it wanting, made promises, and I just didn't feel those promises lived up to experience. And that was kind of where I was. Yeah, well, I think you've got to remember that over 30 years, Catherine was praying. Okay, so there's that underpinning, 33 years of faithful praying. And then she got really frustrated with me one day, and she just said, you're not searching for God. And I said, well, I am. And I kind of was, but it was half-hearted. So I thought, well, okay, what do you want me to read? I'll read something. And so I went to the bookcase with her and was looking at it. So she pulled down this book, which was The Purpose-Driven Life by Rick Warren. And I thought, that's a devotional book. Sure, that's the one you want me to read? Okay, so I started to read it, and it's nicely set up in chunks. And as I was reading it through, I was thinking, it's a good book for Christians to read. Christians should read this book. And I found myself reading a part of it, and then he'd quote a verse, and I'd think, did the Bible really say that? And I'd get my phone out and look it up and think, I suppose it does really. But I got to the end of it, and I wasn't really closer, but I was moving in a direction, and I think that was the important thing. Apologetics books wouldn't have done it for me, and books on testimonies really wouldn't have done it for me, because I think, you know, that's other people's experience, that's not mine. But I think one that did help me was David Watson's book, You Are My God, and that's kind of his biography, autobiography. And there he's sort of warts and all about his experience, his conversion, and the way he started off being a curate and the things that he did. It's quite a remarkable story. That kind of drew me in further, and I was reading other books as well. And what I found was that by the time I'd reached that point, I knew I wanted to come back. I knew I wanted to return. And so then I started reading the Bible, started reading the Gospels, particularly John was always my favourite Gospel, so I read through John, and I read through Luke, and those were the things which really began to speak to me. It was when I was reading, it suddenly came across to me that the one thing that was missing in my life had been prayer. And even when I was a Christian, a young Christian, and working in the church, I prayed, but I didn't really have prayer in my life, and that was what was really missing. And I guess I was kind of living semi-detached to God, so he was my neighbour, you know? And I'd see him in the mornings and say, oh yeah, as we were going off. And sometimes I'd go and help him move a bit of furniture, and he'd come around and help move mine. But you can't live a semi-detached life from God. And I believe really very much in the sovereignty of God. And so if you believe that God is in control, that kind of takes away any kind of need or feeling that you want to pray. Because you think, well, if God's going to do something, he'll do it anyway. Why does it need me to pray? And I just totally lost sight in the fact that prayer is about a relationship with God and that closeness with God. And it was when I was kind of reading these things through that it just leapt out at me, and I thought, wow, that was my fault, you know. And then I realized that it wasn't God that was found wanting, it was Ronnie that was found wanting. You know, it wasn't God's promises that's failed, it was my promises to God that had failed. And I just really began to see that was really my major fault, my major flaw. You really have to be close to God. And I think that's where I've been since then. It's just that hunger to want to be in God's presence with prayer. I met up with a Christian youth group. It was through someone that I worked with, and he was a bit mixed up himself, because he also became a Mormon. So I I started also going to the Mormon church as well. So I was sort of in between both camps. It was reading one of the hymns. I was in a Mormon church and we were singing one of their hymns. And one of the lines in the hymn came out to me and it said, "When we've proven worthy of thy sacrifice divine." And I suddenly thought, we can never do that. We can never be worthy. We can't earn our way to heaven. And it kind of all came in, and I kind of understood then the gospel, that it wasn't anything that we'd done. It wasn't any way that we could earn salvation. And that really then drew me back. So that was the last time I went to the Mormon church. But it was just that realization that I suppose a lot of people are trying to subconsciously earn their way to heaven, you know, and you meet people out there and it's all very easy to think that people should turn away from their sins. That's easy for us. But also it's trying to communicate to some people they need to turn away from what they're resting on, and that's doing their good works, doing their good deeds. Because no matter what you do, you can never be good enough.
Love so